Hi everybody, Joe here again and welcome back. So today we're going to be talking about the do-it-yourself CO2 system. In this video I'm going to show you all the main components that you're going to need that are required to run your system. We're going to show you how to build and run the CO2 generator, the gas separator, as well as the diffuser. All of these are pretty much mandatory for the type of system I'm going to show you guys how to do. We're going to keep costs low, we're going to keep the build easy, and overall maintenance fees and costs of running it on a continuous basis, we're going to make sure those stay low and easy as well. I'm going to tell you guys how to size the CO2 to your tank. I'm going to tell you basically how much it will cost, as well as everything else that you're really going to need. We're going to start out by taking a look at some of the components and all the materials that you're going to need. Now before you get started, a lot of you guys might not even know what a CO2 system is. Well, essentially what it is it's going to be a CO2 generator. It's going to generate CO2. It's essentially what it's going to do. And then what that's going to do is allow you to run your planet aquariums. Your plants obviously need CO2, and sometimes, and in most cases, there's just simply not enough CO2 in your aquarium for your plants to flourish. While they'll still grow, they won't grow as well as if they had CO2. So adding the CO2 tanks or systems are definitely going to be an asset to any aquarium that would like to experiment or start to grow plants, and that's what we're going to do. So essentially, let's start off by taking a look at some of the parts and some of the equipment that we're going to need, and then go from there. Okay, so let's take a look at some of the materials. This is going to be pretty familiar to a lot of you guys, because this idea has been around for a long time. First of all, you're going to need some bottles. Just basic juice, pop, water, whatever you got, bottles. I'm using 500 milliliter bottles with a plastic cap. Took the cover off, rinsed it out, it's good to go. Now you might be wondering, what size bottle do you need? We're going to talk more about that later on in the video when we start to make up the mixture for the CO2. So make sure you pay attention for that. Nonetheless, you need a plastic bottle, and you're actually probably going to need at least three of them, and that's just going to be for the CO2 generators as well as the gas separator. You guys will see more on that later, stay with me. So you're going to need the bottles. You'll also need some silicone airline tubing, okay? Now, the silicone airline tubing is, you know, it's going to be run-of-the-mill stuff. It's at your common, it's at your pet store for sure. It runs at a quarter inch. Okay. Now, in terms of cost, so far we're at, you know, the plastic water bottles. You typically return them for 5 cents if it's available in your area, or you know, you throw them out. So costs for those are free. You're probably already going to have some kicking around your house, like I did. Airline tubing, you know, it's typically pretty cheap, about 10 cents a foot. You're not going to need a lot. You'll probably only need about six feet total, depending on the size of your aquarium and where you're actually placing your generator. But let's round it up to an even dollar, okay? So we're looking at a dollar in cost so far. Third thing you're going to need is check line valves. Now, probably can't see it from there, but let me I'll give you a closer look. So, it's not going to focus there, but nonetheless, it's basically what this is, and what it's going to do is, they're pretty common. You guys have seen them before as well at your pet stores or, you know, on your aquarium. Use them on air pumps that go right onto your air line. And what they're made for is really a really simple purpose. They allow air to travel one way, but not the other way. Okay? So it's a check valve. They're a safety precaution is what they are. Okay, you'll also need a small suction cup with a nub on the end. This is essentially to attach the diffuser in the aquarium. We'll see more about that later on. The cost on these, I had to kick it around, so it was free. You'll also need some yeast. I buy it in packets just because I use about, you know, typically about a half pack or less per batch. This will last me well over a month, and I'm going to round up on this one as well. It costs $2. It's 8 grams in each packet. I'll tell you exactly how much we're going to be using later on in the video. But so far, for a month of of CO2 or a month and a half, we're looking at, what we say, $2, $3 so far. Oh, the check valve's about $1 as well, so we're looking at $4. Then your sponge. This is very optional. This depends on how you want to do your diffuser. I've got some very fine sponge here. Got it for $1. So what do we have? $4 or $5, something like that. And then a piece of wood, you know, free, kicking around outside. I had it. As you can see, I drilled it with 3 holes. I'll show you what that's for later. So, nonetheless, I think that's all, everything that's going to take to build my CO2 generator, and we're at $5. Like before, I lost count there. $5 isn't bad. And we're looking at having to pay $2 a month, at most, to run this 10-gallon aquarium. Might cost you more depending on the size of your aquarium, but it's probably, if you're going up to about 40 gallons, you're not going to be over $5 a month. You really can't beat that. So, let's get started with putting this thing... Okay, so let's start off by having a look at the layout of this CO2 generator and the entire system here. This here is not mandatory, it's just a piece of wood with 1.5-inch holes drilled into it. The reason for this is I found that when building these before, the bottles were flying all over the place, they're always tipping over. This will keep them all in place and weighted down once the mixtures are in each of them. Now, being 1.5-inch, I can simply put a bottle in there, put them all side by side, and they're in there nice and snug. They're not coming out. Okay. Now if we put 3 beside it, we'll put 3 of them in here. Okay, so that's really what it's going to look like at the in the end. Now as you can see, there's holes in the tops of these. Notice there's 1 in the first, 1 in the second, and 3 in the third. Probably wondering what those are for. Well, the first two are your CO2 generators. These two bottles are what going to generate the CO2. Now the CO2 is actually going to be generated out of a liquid of yeast and sugar as well as some water. What's going to happen there is there's going to be a CO2 gas produced, and it's going to want to escape out the bottle. But what we're going to do is attach some silicone tubing, and what we want to do here is simply take off the tops, and all I did was use a 1/4-inch drill saw or drill hole in there so that the silicone tubing can fit in there. Now this actually isn't going to fit in like this because the silicone tubing is actually a little bit wider on the outside than this hole is. So what that's going to allow me to do is I'm going to have to pinch the end here. It's not easy to do, but once you pinch the end and push it through, it creates its own seal. Since it's silicone, it creates its own seal, almost like a bulkhead. A lot of people like to silicone them in place, so that's optional as well. And what we're looking to do here is, let me see if I can just do it for you guys. Okay, so we've pinched it and pushed it through. Perfect. It's not too difficult, more annoying than anything. Now, you don't want the hole so big that it keeps it pinched. You just want it to go through pretty simply. And that's about as far into the bottle as we're going to have it. It's almost flush with the top there. This is going to allow us to screw this on. We're going to do the same for this one. And then these two here are going to go into the sides like this. Okay, let me go ahead and hook all this up, and then we'll move on to the next step. Okay, now they're all attached and hooked up now. As you can see, the first bottle leads into the third bottle, the second bottle also leads into the third bottle, while the third bottle leads somewhere else, and that's actually leading to the tank. But before it does, it has to go through the check valve so the air can pass through it. But if the CO2 generator stops producing any gas, it means it's going to stop producing pressure, and water will be able to back siphon down. And you don't want that to go into your bottles or possibly flood your floor, so you put the check valve there so the water can't pass through. Now, so what's happening here is, you guys are probably even still wondering, you know, how does this even work? Well, these two bottles produce the CO2. The air and gas is going to travel up into the second, or in, I'm sorry, into the third bottle. You actually don't need third bottles. You really only need one. I'm using 2 because I didn't want to use 1-liter bottles. Now,
So as the gas is produced and travels into the third bottle, the gas pressure in this bottle is going to build up and then want to pass back out through here. The reason why we have this gas separator is because it's separating the gas from any potential liquid or fluid that also travels up through the generators that you don't want in your aquarium. You don't want the fluid that's going to be in here into your tank. So just in case it does travel up the tube, this is going to separate in here, and then the raw gas is going to go back up into your aquarium. Okay, so now let's talk about the actual CO2 mixture, how much you need, how to size it to your aquarium, and then move on to the diffuser. Okay, so now that we have all the components down, we know how it works, we know everything that's needed in terms of the CO2 generator and the gas separator, it's time to actually make the liquid for the CO2 generator. Now, what we're going to do here is very simple. We're going to need some water, we're going to need some sugar, and we're also going to need your yeast and hot water source, something that's over 100 degrees Fahrenheit. Whether you got to boil it or not, you'll have to do that. Now, what is the mixture you need, and how much works for how big of a tank? It's going to be a big question. Well, for every 1 liter of, and these are 500 milliliters, so let's imagine one of these were a liter. For every 1 liter bottle, it'll run about a 10-gallon aquarium. Now, in a 1 liter bottle, the mixture is very simple. You need one cup of sugar, 1 cup of water, an eighth of a teaspoon of yeast, and an eighth of a teaspoon of that hot water. The way it works is simple. Dump in your sugar, then dump in your 1 cup of water on top of it, mix it up, then we activate the yeast. We activate the yeast with that hot water. We take the eighth of a teaspoon of the yeast, eighth of a teaspoon of the hot water, mix it up, dump it into the CO2 generator as well, letting the yeast activate for about 2, 3, 4 minutes before dumping it in is a good idea. Now, for every mixture of that size, it'll run about a 10-gallon aquarium. The reason why we don't want to go over 40 gallons with this type of system is really simple. You don't need a bunch of bottles under your tank. It simply becomes a little cumbersome. Maintenance becomes a little bit too much because you're going to have to do this almost weekly. And, you know, cost starts to become a factor. You're constantly having to buy sugar, etc. How long will this last? Well, in a 1 liter bottle would last about 7 to 8 days. So with your weekly water changes, or however often you do them, you can change out your mixture at the same time. You can play with that mixture, but if you're going to play with the mixture, add more or less yeast. The sugar and water amount is fine. Now, in a 2 liter bottle, the mixture lasts for about 15 to 16 days, so you're getting a little more than double the time. Now, two 2-liter bottles will run up to about a 40-50 gallon aquarium, and that's where you want to max out. You don't want to have 3, 4, 5 2-liter bottles under your tank. Unless you really want to, it's up to you, but I suggest upgrading to a cylinder, a CO2 cylinder in a proper system. Okay, so nonetheless, now that we know the mixture and how to do it, we're going to put those two mixtures into these bottles, the first two bottles, which were the gas generators. The CO2 generators, and then leave the gas separator empty. Now we move up to creating the diffuser. What I mean by diffuser is simple. We need the bubbles that this is going to create. It's going to create bubbles of CO2 within your water. But those bubbles are too large and they don't last long enough in the aquarium. They rise too fast, meaning they're not dissolving into the aquarium and the plants really aren't using them. They're dissipating at the surface. So we need something to keep the bubbles in the tank long enough for them to dissolve, or chop them up fine enough for them to be a little bit easier to dissolve in the aquarium. Now, there's multiple ways to go about doing this. What you're seeing here is pretty common, but the actual diffuser, there's so many ways that you can do it. I'm going to show you a couple ways that that I've done it. So let's move on to that right now. Okay guys, so we're now on to the diffuser. Now, as I mentioned earlier, the purpose of the diffuser is actually one of the most important aspects to this entire system. Without a proper diffuser or diffusing the CO2 into the aquarium properly, the point and the whole reason for having the CO2 system is basically void. If the CO2 is traveling up through the water column too quickly and not dissolving, then there's no point to having any of this. You want the CO2 to dissolve at least at a rate that the plants can absorb it in time. So, keeping on the theme of keeping things simple and easy, what we're going to do is look at a really simple diffuser that I've used for quite a while, and it tends to work quite well for me. There's a number of things and a number of different diffusers you can go ahead and use if you don't want to use this idea. You know, you won't hurt my feelings. Go ahead. This is simply just a way that I found works and is really simple and quick to do. What we're going to do is take another bottle. We're going to go ahead and cut it in half, or at least cut some of it off. We're going to take that suction cup we looked at earlier, drill a hole through the bottle at some point in the bottle. Right in the midsection is typically the best spot, and insert the suction cup there. You can silicone it in place if you need to, but if it has a small nub on the end, you won't have to. From there, we're going to drill a hole at the bottom of the bottle, big enough to insert an airline hose into. But before we do that, we want to take that sponge that we looked at the first of the video. This is a very fine sponge, and what that's going to do is roll up quite nicely and fit right up into the bottle here. Okay? From there, we locate our hole that we made earlier for the airline hose. We insert that airline hose and pull it through right to the middle of the bottle here. And now what's going to happen is, as the CO2 generator generates the CO2, that gas rises through the airline hose and escapes through the top. Now those bubbles now have to travel through this sponge here, and it's going to chop it up into fine pieces and absorb it a little bit and hold it in the water a lot longer. Some's going to come out the top, of course, but it should be smaller bubbles. Now all we do here is place it into your aquarium, just like that, wherever you want. Just make sure that it's right side up. It's pretty straightforward and simple. Now that's essentially it, guys. Now let's take a look at it on an actual aquarium so you can really get an idea as to how this works. Okay, guys, so I just freshly installed the CO2 system onto this aquarium here. It's the same size that I had earlier that you seen in the video, just a different one. The generator does typically take a couple of hours to start building the pressure up and start generating the actual CO2, so it's going to be a little while before mine starts actually generating those bubbles. Now, how many bubbles you need per hour, per minute, depend on a number of factors, especially the lighting you have, the plants you're keeping, etc. We're not going to get into that. I'm sure Google or another website like DIY Fish Keepers can help you out there. So, it's another thing we're going to talk about real quickly. If you need to slow down your bubbles, there's a number of things you can do. There's typically two things you can do. You guys might have noticed that I had two smaller containers, two gas generators. My flow's too much, I can simply take one off. If my flow is too much and I can't take one off because I'm just using one big container, I can put a micro ball valve on the airline and slow the bubbles down if I need to. If I need to add more bubbles, I'd simply add another generator in there. In this tank, you guys are probably going to ask what kind of plants there are. I got some Christmas moss at the bottom, I got some Anubias, and some Java fern. All easy to grow, low maintenance, don't need substrate, nothing. You know, I'm not much of a plant guy, I'm always bare tanks, you guys know that. But I wanted to make this video especially for you guys, so I had to get some plants, had to set up a tank especially for this video. So I hope you enjoyed the video, I hope you enjoyed the content, and we'll see you next time.